Hello and welcome to the podcast. This is Ron's Amazing Stories. We have stories that should thrill you a little and chill you a little.
It's amazing.
What you'll hear are adventures sent in by you guys, classic stories from the pulp mags, and episodes from the golden age of radio. We have special segments like Ghost Stories with Sylvia.
That's amazing.
And These Are Your Stories. So settle in for the next hour and enjoy the show. One more thing. You just might want to prepare yourself to be taken away from today.
Another 5-minute mystery.
This 5-minute mystery is being brought to you by...
Hi, my name is Henry.
Hello?
I was told to report here for voiceover work.
Yeah, I fired both OP and BG for taking over the podcast last week.
Great. What do you need me to do?
Our story takes us to the Long Island home of wealthy Mrs. Nottingham. Set in dense growth on a hill, lonesome, secluded, and dark. The shadow of a human figure climbs into a window, crosses the unlighted room to a safe in the wall. 2 minutes later, the figure is gone, and in a matter of minutes, turmoil rules the house.
Oh, this is terrible. Terrible. Philip, who could have done such a thing?
Did anybody know you had the sapphire hair, Mrs. Nottingham?
Only Jamie and I. It was just delivered from the bank this afternoon.
What's going on down here?
Oh, Jamie.
What? The safe. Afraid we've had a thief in the night, Jamie.
They've stolen the sapphire. It's gone. Jamie, could it have been one of the servants?
But Anne, Nora, none of them knew the stone was here.
What's that stuck back in the safe there?
Well, it's an envelope addressed to me.
What? Well, then let's open it. Plain paper, typewritten. It says, 7th November, 1945, dear Mrs. Nottingham. Meet me at the old stone mill Wednesday night at 9. Bring with you $5,000 in cash, small bills... and I will return your sapphire. If you report this theft, you'll never see the Nottingham sapphire again.
No signature?
No. Whoever did it must have known the stone was to be brought here, Aunt Laura. Look at the date. 7th November. That was yesterday. This robbery must have been planned for days.
Well, there's nothing to do except get the stone back again. Tomorrow night at 9 o'clock, I'll meet our thief at the old stone mill. So he was as good as his word, Inspector Webster. I went alone to the mill, handed him the money, took the sapphire, and left.
Yes, and a day later, you reported the matter to the police.
But my aunt had to be sure of getting the stone back, Inspector.
I begged Mrs. Nottingham to let me accompany her. Since I came from England 3 weeks ago, I've been a guest in her house. I wanted to help.
But this note, it tells us a great deal, Mrs. Nottingham.
What, Inspector?
Whoever wrote it is obviously the thief. Someone who was close enough to you to manage the combination of the safe.
I'm afraid that's true, Anwar.
The sapphire was delivered from the bank a few hours before it was stolen. And only you, Mrs. Nottingham, and your nephew knew about it. None of the servants did. Mr. Philip Harrison here. Is he the only Englishman in your house?
Why, yes.
And do you really want to find the thief?
Oh, of course we do.
Then I may as well tell you. I'm arresting Mr. Harrison as the thief. Come along, Harrison. I'll take your confession at headquarters.
What led Inspector Webster to believe Philip Harrison was the culprit? In a moment, we'll hear the solution, but first...
Okay, Henry. What did you think of the story so far?
Quite simple, really. You see, the whole conceptual emphasis is based on the date numerical systems and differences between the U.S. and English calendaring.
What?
We use different numerical placements. Therefore, the culprit is quite obvious.
To you? You're fired, Henry.
I can see you are a difficult man to work for, and appear to be an idiot.
You're still fired.
And you're still an idiot.
And now, back to our story.
Until Philip Harrison confessed, we had no proof of his guilt, although the note itself was enough for me. As you probably know, we Americans always date our letters by first designating the month, then the day. In England, the custom is different. Letters are dated day first, then the month. As in the note, 7th November, 1945. So you can see, in that note, Philip Harrison unconsciously wrote his own confession.
You see, Ron, it's simple logic.
I thought I fired you, Henry.
You did.
And you're still here?
I have something to say.
Go ahead.
Ron! You're so stupid that on applications that say sign here, you put Leo.
What else would I put?
My point exactly.
Is that you said?
Hello, and welcome to the podcast. On the show today, we have stories.
As it should be.
We have a creepy one from Faye. We hear as she explores a very strange house. Then we head to the pulp fiction scene for a crazy story about a TV repairman. We will end the show with one from Suspense. Have you ever heard the phrase, ship of the desert?
What's it about?
A man finds a lost ship in the desert, and the result, well, is not good. We start the show with a moment in time presented to you by Audible. The date is September 29th, 1954, and this is A Moment in Time. One of my all-time favorite baseball players was Willie Mays. Mays, nicknamed the Say Hey Kid, spent almost all of his 22-season career playing for the New York / San Francisco Giants. I, personally, was beginning my Little League career when Mays was finishing his in New York. I remember collecting his bubblegum card and wishing that I could get the thing signed by the Say Hey Kid. One of his most memorable moments came on September 29, 1954. Here is that moment, as reported by the great sports announcer, Jack Brickhouse.
There's a long drive way back in center field, way back, back, it is home! Second, Toby is able to go to third. Willie Mays just brought this crowd to its feet with a catch, which must have been an optical illusion to a lot of people. Boy! Notice where that 483-foot mark is in center field. The ball itself, Russ, you know this ballpark better than anyone else I know, had to go about 460, didn't it? It certainly did, and I don't see how Willie did it, but he's been doing it all year.
That moment went on to be called The Catch. It was made by Mays on September 29, 1954, during Game 1 of the 1954 World Series. During the eighth inning, with the score tied 2-2, Cleveland batter Vic Wirtz hit a deep fly ball to center field that was poised to score all of the runners on base. However, Mays made an over-the-shoulder catch that is regarded as one of the greatest plays in baseball history. And this was A Moment in Time. This moment in time was brought to you by Audible. They have more stories than you can possibly imagine, and you can get a 30-day free trial and a free audiobook at audibletrial.com/Ron's Amazing Stories. They built the medium that redefines the spoken word.
These are your stories, sent by you, for you.
Our story comes from the city of Chester, Virginia, and was sent in by Faye Rogers. It is quite creepy, and Faye has titled it, Daggerheart Station. Hello, Ron. I have a story that I've been wanting to share with everyone for a while. It involves a building that my friend and I found in the woods over a decade ago that was truly haunted, or just a place of pure evil. I don't think we'll ever know. Maybe, for whatever crazy reason, someone has come across this place as well, and I would love to hear about it. On a pretty busy street across from a Walmart shopping center, there is a veterinarian office. Behind this office are nothing but woods. Not that far off into the woods was an abandoned building that a couple of my friends had heard some crazy rumors about. We were deep into ghost hunting around this time and just had to go see this for ourselves. We parked at the vet's office parking lot and made our way into the woods. After about 2 minutes of walking, we see it. An odd-shaped building with a couple broken-down vehicles to the side of it. No driveway, no mailbox, no type of yard. We looked around the area and we could still see the vet's office. We could see the street and the cars passing through the trees. All we could think about is, what the heck is this random thing doing here? We slowly made our way inside. When we walked through the double-wide front door, the first thing we saw was a purse hanging from the ceiling. There were stairs to the right, and near those on the ground was another purse and a child's pink jacket. It's been over a decade now, and I remember this all so very vividly. The floor was completely warped, as if it had been flooded at some point. There was no graffiti anywhere, which I thought was odd. To the left was a room that I will never forget and will drive me crazy to this day. The door was closed. We walked into it, and every wall was covered with Bible passages. Someone had ripped pages out one by one out of the Bible and taped them over every part of every wall. The only area that wasn't completely covered had a hand-painted image in the middle of it. It was a dagger going through a heart. I'd say it was about 4 feet tall and 3 feet wide. It was the weirdest, most unnerving thing I had ever seen. The vibes I got, not just in the building, but this specific room, were unspeakably negative. What the hell could have been going on here? We decided to take a peek upstairs. Nothing nearly as crazy as already described, but still weird. A fold-out chair was facing the window, and an old coffee cup was still on the sill. One twin-size mattress was on the floor, and a small rendition of the heart and dagger was also drawn on the floor. You just knew something wasn't right here. The place was a dead quiet. We were looking around when suddenly we heard a scream. It was full of anguish and anger. I can still feel it in my bones, and yes, I do mean feel it. It sounded like it was coming from downstairs. We ran down there, and what we saw was hard to describe. A body was hanging from the ceiling where the purse was before. The pink child's coat was wrapped around it, and it was thrashing about like it was in its death throes. My friend screamed and ran out the front door. I soon followed, being chased out by a second scream from the thing. A couple years later, we went back. The place had fallen into further decay, and someone had hauled off the cars. We decided to take some pictures. We saw tons of orbs in them. We took a picture of the upstairs window from the outside. There was a very distinct red orb hovering there. Guess it could have been dust. Who knows? I do know that there are some twisted people out there, and I think something bad happened in that place. I drove by this area today, and it made me want to share this story. The woods have been cleared out now, and the building no longer exists. I can't believe there's never been made any mention of this place since then or before. Faye Rogers, Chester, Virginia. Well, Faye, I tried to do some research on your story and the address you sent me. I wanted to help try to make some sense of it. What I came up with is that I think your building may, at one time, have been a train station. Chester's original downtown was a stop of the Richmond and Petersburg Railroad, running north to south. The two services merged with the Atlantic coastline, and that new railroad became the Tidewater Railroad in 1905. The Chester station was closed down, but the land remained property of the railroad. Now, this doesn't explain what happened there, but it might explain why your building was in the middle of nowhere. Thank you for your story. Well, that's it for this time. If you have a story you want to share, like Faye did, head to the main website at ronsamazingstories.com and click on the story submission banner. Leave your story, give it a title, and tell me where you're from. I'll read it if I can.
As read by Amazing Stories, read by Amazing People.
This time on As Read By, we have a very strange story. In today's world, televisions really are a thing of the past. Everything is flat panel, OLED screens, and is streamed from this service or that provider. The days of tubes and cathodes are long gone. But there was a day when a television repairman was a thing, and he would actually come to your house to fix your TV. This is a story that comes from that time and presents a concept that should be considered supernatural. Our story is titled Something Will Turn Up by David Mason, and is read for us by Miss Corey Samuel.
You, Mr. Rapp? Stanley Rapp blinked, considering the matter. He always thought over everything very carefully. Of course, some questions were easier to answer than others. This one, for instance. He had very few doubts about his name. Stanley Rapp said. Yes, yes. He stared at the bearded young man. Living in the village, even on the better side of it, one saw beards every day, all shapes and sizes of beard. This one was not a psychoanalyst beard, or a folk singer beard, not even an actor beard. This was the scraggly variety, almost certainly a poet beard. Mr. Rapp, while holding no particular prejudice against poets, had not sent for one, he was sure of that. Then he noticed the tool case in the bearded young man's hand, lettered large, Lightning Service, TV, Hi-Fi. Oh, Stanley said, nodding. You're the man to fix the TV set. You know it, Dad, the young man said, coming in. He shut the door behind him and stared around the apartment. What a wild pad! Where the idiot box, hey? The pleasantly furnished, neat little apartment was not what Mr. Rapp had ever thought of as a wild pad. But the village had odd standards, Mr. Rapp knew. Chacun a son goût, he had said, on moving into the apartment 10 years ago. Not allowed, of course, because he had only taken 1 year of French and would never have trusted his accent. But chacun a son goût, anyway. The television set, Mr. Rapp said, translating. Oh, yes. He went to the closet door and opened it. Reaching inside, he brought out an imposingly large TV set, mounted on a wheeled table. The bearded repairman whistled. In the closet, the repairman said, admiringly. Crazy. You go in there to watch it, or you let it talk to itself? Oh, well, I don't exactly watch it at all, Mr. Rapp said, a little sadly. I mean, I can't. That's why I called you. Lightning's here, have no fear, the bearded one said, approaching the set with a professional air. Like, in the closet, hey. He bent over the set, appraisingly. I thought you were a square, Pops, but I can see your... Hey, this is like too much. Man, I don't want to pry, but Why is this box upside down?
I wish I knew, Mr. Rapp said. He sat down and leaned back, sighing. This was going to be difficult, he knew. He had already had to explain it to the last three repairmen, and he was getting tired of explaining. Although he thought, somehow, that this young man might understand it a little more quickly than the others had.
I've had a couple of other repairmen look it over, Mr. Rapp told the bearded one. They gave up.
Dilettantes, commented the beard.
Oh no, Mr. Rapp said. One of them was from the company that made it, but they couldn't do anything.
Let's try it, the repairman said, plugging the cord into a wall socket. He returned to the set and switched it on, without changing its upside-down position. The big screen lit almost at once. A pained face appeared, with a large silhouetted hammer striking the image's forehead in a rhythmic beat.
Immediate relief from headache, a bland voice said, as the pictured face broke into a broad smile.
The repairman shuddered and turned down the sound, staring at the image with widened eyes as he did so.
Dad, I don't want to bug you, the repairman said, his eyes still on the screen. Only, look, the set is upside down, right?
Right, said Mr. Rapp.
Only the picture.
The repairman paused, trying to find the right phrase.
I mean, the picture's flipped, like it's wrong side up too, only right side up now.
Exactly, said Mr. Rapp. You see, that's the trouble. I put the set upside down because of that.
Cool, the repairman said, watching the picture. I mean, so why worry? You got a picture, right? You want me to turn the picture around? I can do that with a little fiddling around inside the set.
Uh-oh. Dad, something's happening.
The repairman bent closer, staring at the picture. It was now showing a busty young woman singer, her mouth opened, but silent, since the sound was turned down. She was slowly rotating as Rapp and the bearded repairman watched, turning until her face, still mouthing silent song, hung upside down on the screen.
It always does that, Rapp said. No matter which way I put the set, the picture's always upside down.
No, man, the repairman said, pleadingly. Look, I took a course. I mean, the best school, you dig? It don't work that way. It just can't.
It does, though, Rapp pointed out. And that's what the other repair people said, too. They took it out and brought it back, and it still did it. Not when they had it in their shops, but the minute it came back here, the picture went upside down again.
Wow, the repairman said, backing slowly away from the set, but watching it with the tense gaze of a man who expected trouble. After a minute, he moved toward it again and took hold of the cabinet's sides, lifting.
I don't want to put you down, Pops, he said, grunting. Only I got to see this. Over she goes.
He set it down again, right side up. The picture, still the singer's face, remained in a relatively upright position for another moment, and then slowly rolled over, upside down again.
You see, Mr. Rapp said, shrugging. I guess I'll have to buy another set, except I'd hate to have it happen again, and this one did cost quite a lot.
You couldn't trade it in, either, the repairman agreed. Not to me, anyway.
Suddenly, he snapped his fingers. Hey now, sideways?
You mean on its side?
Just for kicks.
The repairman gripped the set again.
On the side.
He set the cabinet down on one side and stepped back to regard the picture again. Slowly, the picture turned once more, and once again, relative to the usual directions of up and down, the picture was stubbornly, completely, inverted.
It's onto that, too, the repairman said gloomily.
He sat down on the floor and assumed a kind of yoga posture, peering between his legs.
You could try it this way, Pops. I'm pretty stiff, Mr. Rapp told him,
shaking his head.
Yeah, the repairman said, reinverting himself.
For a long while he sat, pulling his beard thoughtfully, a look of deep thought on his face. The reversed singer faded out,
to give place to an earnestly grinning announcer who pointed emphatically to a large upside-down sign bearing the name of a product. "Watching it this way could get to be a fad," the repairman said at last, almost inaudibly. He fell silent again, and Mr. Rapp, sadly, began to realize that even this bearded and confident young man had apparently been stopped, like the others. "The way I look at it, like, there's a place where science hangs up," the bearded one spoke, finally. "Like, I don't want to put down my old guru at the Second Avenue School of Electronics," he added solemnly. "But you got to admit that there are things not dreamed of in your philosophy, Horatio. You dig?" "My name isn't Horatio," Mr. Rapp objected. "I was quoting," the repairman told him. "I mean, this is a thing like outside material means. Supernatural, sort of. Did you cross up any witches lately, Pops?" "Oh dear," Mr. Rapp said sadly. He shook his head. "No, I haven't, offended any witches. Not that I know of." He regarded the inverted picture for a moment. Then, as the repairman's words began to sink in, Mr. Rapp looked at him apprehensively. "Witches?" Mr. Rapp asked. "But, I mean, that's all superstition, isn't it? And anyway, well, television sets." "They used to dry up cows, but who keeps cows?" the bearded one said ominously. "Why not television sets? Like, I happen to be personally acquainted with several witches and like that. The village is full of them. However." He rose and stalked toward the set, his eyes glittering in a peculiar way. "You're a lucky one, Daddy-o. Back in my square days, I did some reading up on the hookups between poetry and magic. Now I'm a poet. Therefore, and to wit, I'm also a magician. On this hang-up, I'm going to try magic. Electronics won't work, that's for sure." "But." Mr. Rapp was not quite sure why he disapproved, but he did. On the other hand, the repairman appeared to be very definitely sure of what he was doing as he peered into the back of the television set. "Have you ever tried, this method before?" "Never ran into any hexed TV sets before," the repairman said, straightening up. "Don't worry, though. I got the touch, like with poetry. Same thing, in fact. All magic spells rhyme, see? Well, I used to rhyme back before I really started swinging. Anybody can rhyme, and the rest is just instinct." He had been scribbling something on a notepad as he spoke. Now he bent down to take another look at the back of the set, and nodded with an air of assurance. "The tube layout," the repairman told Mr. Rapp, exhibiting his notebook. "That and Ohm's Law and a couple of Hindu bits I picked up listening to the UN on the radio makes a first-class spell." Mr. Rapp backed away nervously. "Look, if it's all the same to you..." "Don't flip." The repairman consulted his notebook and moved to stand in front of the screen. The picture showed a smiling newscaster pointing to a map which indicated something ominous. "Cool, man," the repairman said. "Here we go." He lifted his hands in an ecclesiastical gesture, and his voice became a deep boom. 6SN7AC5, 6 and 7 millivolts are running down the line. E equals R times A, that's the way it goes. Round the other way, Supas Chandra Bose. Afterward, Mr. Rapp was never quite sure exactly what happened. He had an impression of a flash of light, and an odd, indefinite sound, rather like the dropping of a cosmic garbage can lid. But possibly neither the light nor the sound actually happened. At any rate, there were no complaints from the neighbours later on. However, the lighted screen was certainly doing something. "Crazy," the repairman said, in awed tones. Mr. Rapp, his view partly blocked by the repairman, could not see exactly what was happening on the screen. However, he caught a brief glimpse of the newscaster's face. It was right side up, but no longer smiling. Instead, the pictured face wore a look of profound alarm, and the newsman was apparently leaning far forward, his face almost out of focus because of its nearness to the lens. Just for a moment, Mr. Rapp could have sworn he saw a chair floating up, past the agonized expression on the screen. Then the screen went grey, and a panel of lettering appeared, shaking slightly. "Our picture has been temporarily interrupted. Normal service will be restored as soon as possible. Please stand by."
"I was going to give you a bill," the repairman said. "Only, maybe we'd better just charge it up to customer relations."
The letters remained steady on the screen, and Mr. Rapp studied them. They were right side up.
"You fixed it," Mr. Rapp said, a little uncertainly. "I mean, it's working. I ought to pay."
"I goofed," the repairman said. He picked up his tools and moved toward the door. "Like, I won't mention it to anybody if you won't. But I goofed, all right? Didn't you see the picture?"
"But whatever you did, it worked," Mr. Rapp said. "The picture's right side up."
"I know," the repairman said. "Only somewhere, there's a studio that's upside down. I just goofed, Pops, that's all." He closed the door behind him, leaving Mr. Rapp still staring at the immobile, right-side-up message on the glowing screen.
I absolutely loved this story. It reminded me of a day when the TV could actually be a magical device. Our story was first published in Analog Magazine in February of 1963. It was attributed to David Mason, but that was not his real name. Samuel Mason was the actual writer who began publishing in the pulp mags in 1955 under various names. He was best known for Cavan's World in 1969 and its sequel, The Return of Cavan, in 1972. These were your routine sword and sorcery stories. However, his final book, The Deep Gods, in 1973, is a crazy story that implants a 20th century mentality into the brain of a prehistoric man, where he must deal with the insanity of a whale that threatens to destroy Eden. Crazy stuff. I think you can see that Sam had quite the imagination. In all, he wrote 8 novels and countless short stories during his lifetime. He truly was one of the founding members of the Golden Age of Science Fiction.
The big red letters stand for the Jell-O family. That's Jell-O.
Yum, yum, yum.
Jell-O pudding.
Yum, yum, yum.
Jell-O duck. The yolk of pudding just
Our featured story comes from the world of Suspense. You know, that famous OTR series that ran on CBS Radio from 1940 through 1962. It was the premier drama program of the golden age of radio, and it was subtitled Radio's Outstanding Theater of Thrills. Now, have you ever heard the phrase Ship of the Desert? That usually refers to the camel, but in our story, it has a more literal connotation. It is titled, The Lost Ship. There have been many stories about ships lost at sea, but in the desert? Not many. This one first aired on Suspense in August of 1962.
And now, a tale well calculated to keep you in suspense. The Lost Ship, written especially for Suspense by Irwin Lewis.
It's a sharp curve ahead, Harry. Be careful.
Don't worry, I see it. That was a close one.
Harry, you hear something?
What? It
sounds like a siren. Harry, it does sound like a siren, doesn't it?
Shut up, let me listen. Yeah, I think you're right.
Maybe it's the police.
How could it be? We lost some hours ago.
I don't know, but it's getting louder.
Can't take any chances. We better get off this main road fast. Yeah, that looks like a cutoff.
Oh, but it leads straight across the desert. It isn't much of a road.
No time to be choosy. Hang on. We can't cut back. Those police might be patrolling the highway. We'll wait until dark.
Oh, can't you slow down? I'm getting sick.
It's just a little longer, honey. I want to put as much distance between us and the highway as possible.
What happened?
I don't know. I'll take a look.
What is it?
Broken spring.
Oh, what do we do now?
We can't stay here. Grab the bag and let's go.
Oh, where?
We're on a road of some sort. It's got to lead someplace. Let's try those hills.
What about the suitcase?
Leave it in the car. This little bag is all the luggage we need.
A lot of good it'll do us out here.
Where there's a road, there's bound to be a house of people. What's in this bag talks any language. Come on, let's go. Any
I'm trying, Harry. The bugs are killing me. Oh, I've got to rest a minute.
All right. Here, sit on my jacket.
I'll get it all dirty.
So what? We'll buy 1,000 jackets once we hit the border. Sit down.
Oh, what a relief. What's so hot? What's that?
That sounds like a coyote. Don't worry about it.
Oh, Harry, I'm scared.
Now, don't go hysterical.
Well, aren't you frightened? Even a little?
Sure I am. Down to my shoes.
Oh, we must have been crazy.
There's 50,000 arguments in this little bag to prove we're not crazy.
We'll spend the rest of our lives running.
Once we get to Mexico, we'll stop running.
But we're leaving our home, our friends, everything and everybody we know. Is it worth it?
What are we giving up? A stinking two-room flat with peeling paint and crawling roaches this big? You won't miss that for a minute. You think I enjoyed standing in that teller's cage, handing out money all day long to little people who had no more right to it than I did?
They weren't stealing.
But Doc, don't go moral on me. Listen, I'm past 40. A man gets to that age, he gets tired wanting things and not being able to afford them. Hey, isn't that smoke up there?
Where?
Over to the right, between those two hills. Sure it is. That's chimney smoke. I'll bet there's a house up there. Come on, Viola.
Well, hiya, folks. Kind of off the tourist trail, ain't you?
We were wondering.
No sense wandering outside. Come in. Come in. Make yourselves comfortable. Yeah, your car broke down, huh?
Why do you say that?
Well, nobody'd walk here if they could ride. Yeah, and take a look at your shoes. Lady, I'll bet your feet are full of blisters.
You're so right.
Well, take off your shoes and sit down by the fire. I'll poke it up. Starting to get nippy now. The sun's gone down.
Oh, thank you.
I was fixing myself some supper. Pork and beans. Be mighty proud if you'll join me.
Thank you, Mr.
Tonley, Pete Tonley.
I'm Harry Turner, and this is Mrs. Turner.
I'm pleased to meet you. I'll open another can of beans. It ain't much, but it's spilling.
You live here all alone, Mr. Tonley?
Pete, ma'am, no sense being formal. Yep, I live here all by my lonesome. Going on 20 years, I reckon.
20 years?
You ever have visitors?
Oh, once in a while. Expecting a neighbor of mine. Let's see now. Day after tomorrow.
Neighbor?
Yeah, Sam Higgins. Lives about 40 miles from here. Drops in regular twice a year.
What do you do about supplies, food and things?
Well, I got a Jeep in the back. I use it to go to town once a month for supplies.
A Jeep?
Yeah. Guess you didn't see it coming up here. I'll drive into town first thing in the morning and get Bill Jenkins from the garage to come out and fix up your car.
Can't you go right now?
By the time I get back, it'd be pitch dark. No, better wait till tomorrow. Well, let's see if the beans is... Oh, say, they sure are. Yeah, I hope you don't mind 10 plates. Yeah, well, let's dig in. Yeah, you know, I think those beans are pretty good. Either you folks care for any more?
No, thank you.
No, thank you, Pete. Here, I'll give you a hand with the dishes.
No, don't bother, ma'am. Won't take more than a minute.
I'd like to get that Jeep and take off right now.
Oh, we couldn't do that. He's a nice old man.
I don't like spending the whole night here.
It's safe enough.
Here, let me know when you folks is ready to hit the hay. I'll bunk down in the shed and back.
Oh, no, we wouldn't think of putting you to such trouble.
Oh, don't worry about it, ma'am. I can sleep anywhere, anytime. Besides, that bed ain't much softer than the floor.
Pete, don't you ever get lonely living here by yourself?
No, I like it like this, just me and the hills. I spent nearly 30 years prospecting for gold. Didn't find much, but enough so that I can buy a little food and the few other things they need every now and then. So why look for more? Now, most folks dream about a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. Well, I got that, too, waiting for me over in the hills in the desert out there.
I guess that's what you call a great beyond, huh?
Oh, shucks, no. I don't mean when I'm dead. I'm talking about a real pot of gold, bigger than anything you ever seen or dreamed of, probably.
In the desert?
I don't understand. What is in the desert?
A ship, ma'am. A great Spanish galleon. And it rides the sand dunes of the desert like it was sailing the seas again.
A ship in the desert? That's impossible.
I'll tell you how it was, son. There's a legend that hundreds of years ago, a Spanish ship come sailing up the Gulf of California, having come from Mexico or Peru or one of them other South American places, and as it was sailing up right close to shore, a huge storm come along, followed by a tremendous tidal wave, which swept it clean onto the desert. Must have been the granddaddy of all waves, I reckon. Well, after many years, the waters went back, leaving the ship high and dry, miles from the gulf or the river that feeds into it. In a couple of hundred years, the shifting sands have buried it, of course. But sometimes, when the wind blows up just right, it blows away a lot of the sand. And you can see the upper deck of that old ship from the top of that hill, just over there. According to the legend, too, the hold of that ship is just jam full of treasure.
What a lovely story.
A pretty fairy tale for children and old men.
Harry, that's not a nice thing to say.
Oh, that's all right, ma'am. Of course, he's right. But it is a pretty fairy tale. Just so happens, this fairy tale is true.
What is it, Viola?
Come over here. I want to show you something.
Now, what are you so excited about?
I was straightening out things in the cabin after you left. I found these.
Coins?
Yes, but what kind? Gold coins. And look at the words on them. Onza de oro. That sounds Spanish, doesn't it? Look how old they are.
I see. There's a date on this one. 1542.
What kind of coins are they, Harry?
Seen some like them at an exhibit. They're Spanish doubloons. Where would Pete get them?
Don't you remember his story last night?
What, the Spanish galleon? Don't be ridiculous.
All right, how do you explain them?
I can't. No, it's impossible. Pete.
What's up, son?
My wife found these in the cabin. Where did they come from?
Oh, them things. I reckon they come from the ship.
What do you mean?
Well, some years ago, a young fella come staggering in from the desert. He was in pretty bad shape. Hadn't had food or water for days, it seemed like. I tried to fix him up, but he was too far gone. But before he died, he moaned something about finding a ship out in the desert. I found them coins in his pocket.
I don't believe a word you're saying. You're either crazy or the biggest liar I've ever met.
Harry.
Son, If you're so all-fired skeptical, why don't you climb that hill and take a look for yourself? Now, the wind seems to be coming up kind of strong. You might be lucky. In fact, I got an old pair of field glasses you can take along. But, son, if you do see the ship, for your own sake, don't let it give you any fool ideas.
Harry, I can't climb another foot.
You're almost to the top. Here, grab my hand. There. Now, just a few more feet. Made it.
Oh. Now that we're here, what? I can't see a thing with the wind blowing sand in my face.
I doubt if there is anything to see. That doddery old man tells us a fairy tale and we buy it. All we'll get for our troubles is our lungs full of desert.
Why did I let you talk me into climbing up here? Look at my dress.
Yeah, might as well head back. That old man... Wait a minute. All right, the wind is dying down. Take a look through these glasses. Yeah. I still can't see a blasted thing but sand and sagebrush.
Did you see something?
Can't tell for sure. I'd like it a better focus. Viola!
What is it, Harry?
I don't believe it.
What, Harry?
I see a broken mast and a part of a hull buried in the sand. Viola, the old man was right. There is a ship out there in the desert.
Well, I kind of thought you might see it. Haven't seen it myself in a spell. Figured it was about time for it to show up again.
It was there, just like you said it would be.
You've known it's there all this time, and yet you never went to look for it?
Well, like I told you, son. What for?
Because of the gold. All right, you do what you want. I'm going after that ship.
No, that ain't sensible, son.
Why not? I could see it clearly. It isn't far from here.
Distances are deceiving in the desert. That ship's a lot further than it looks. And that's mighty rough country out there. It's easy to get lost. And if you run out of water, you're finished. And chances are, by the time you got to where you think the ship is, a sandstorm will come up and bury it under tons of sand again. You better forget it.
Not on your life. Your Jeep is equipped with sand tires. It has gas, water, tools. That's all I need.
Ma'am, I surely think it ain't smart. You ought to try to talk him out of it.
Harry, maybe it is too dangerous.
What's the danger? Because Pete can't get up enough energy to drive a few minutes into the desert to make a fortune?
What about the other man who found the ship and died?
I don't know anything about him, and I don't care. There's gold in that ship, I'm going to get it.
But why? We have enough now. You said so yourself.
How can you compare 50,000 to what could be in that ship? And the gold's probably only part of it. Those old Spanish galleons used to come home with their hulls bulging with Inca and Mayan treasures. By God, Viola, we can be rich. We can be rich! We could make a deal with the bank, return the 50,000, and go scot-free.
But you'd be risking your life.
It's worth it. I'm taking the Jeep. You'll see, I'll be back before night.
Now, I've seen what the desert does to people who know it, son. A tenderfoot like you ain't got a chance.
Thanks for the advice, Pete, but I'm going.
Oh, no, Harry, wait. Listen to me.
Let go, Viola.
Pete, stop him, please.
Yeah, your wife's right, son. You ain't thinking clear. At least wait until you can get a well-organized party together.
I haven't got time. Now, get out of my way, Pete.
I can't let you go alone, son. You'll never come back.
Get out of my way!
No, you don't.
Come on, don't get stuck. Now, it can't be much further. The rear wheels are stuck in the sand. Maybe I can slip something underneath. Sun is strong. Yeah, the wheel has dug itself a nice little hole. Well, there's a shovel in the Jeep. If I jam it up against the tire, maybe I... here it is. If I just... Wait a minute, what's over that ridge? Looks like some sort of structure. Can't be a house. Who could live out here? I better take a look. He said distances were deceiving. The top of this ridge looked like it was within a few yards of the Jeep, but I seemed to be walking forever.
The way the heat waves make the air shimmer, I'm not even sure where I am. I'm getting to the top. Now, let's find out just what I saw. There comes that wind again. Can I get the sand out of my eyes? That's better. Now, it's the hull of a ship. Yes, this is what I saw from the hill. Look at her, buried in the sand with little more than part of the top deck visible. But it's a ship, all right. Look at the carvings on the rail. I wonder if it's safe to walk on. Yeah, it seems solid enough. Yeah, there's something inscribed in the railing. Santa Carlotta. Santa Carlotta! I found the ship! I found it! Keep calm. This is only half the bottle. You don't know if the hull is filled with sand or what. Now, let's look for a hatch. Find a hatch and open it. It'll lead to the interior. Clear away the sand. Hey, I hit something. I gotta dig the sand away. I gotta find out what I hit. Come on out, boy. The sun is beginning to set. There's not much time left. I was right. It is a hatch. Now to get it open. Oh, it's jammed. I can't budge it. Wait a minute. Pry it open with a shovel. That's right.
I can feel it, Jimmy. It's coming up.
Get my hand underneath the edge. That's it. That's it. Now my other hand. No, if I can just lift it. I got it. Now, just prop it up with a shovel. That's it. Wait a minute. Here's the top of a ladder. Wonder if it'll hold me. Made it down here. It's a long way up. Can just barely see the hatch opening. Looks like I'm in some sort of passageway. Can't see much now. A cigarette light. It looks like a door. Open it. Furniture? Table? Looks like charts on the walls. Something over in a corner. Can't make out what it is. Looks white. Seems to glisten a little. Wonder what it is. It's a skull. Scared the life out of me. What was your name, Butcher? Was it Yorick? Did you come riding in on this ship when she hit the desert 400 years ago? Take it easy, Harry. Don't lose your nerve now, boy. Well, the wind seems to be getting stronger. Maybe I better go back and get some help. No, not until I find what I came for. Hey, you, Yorick. Maybe you can tell me. Where's the treasure, huh? Maybe you were left here to guard it, huh? Don't talk. All right, let's take a look. Another door. Duck. Come on. Here we are. Dark as night in there. Well, let's see what Yorick was guarding. Wish I brought a flashlight. This lighter doesn't help much. What's this? Looks like some sort of chest. Chest. Okay, now to see what's inside. Mother of heaven. Can't be real. Gold, jewels, diamonds, a chest full. I found it! Magnificent sight. Coins, jewels,
through my pockets. Cram them in. Come on. Wait. There's a burlap bag in the Jeep. I'll get that.
Oh, Viola, Pete. What do you say when I come staring and carrying this magnificent fortune? Can't hold any more. I gotta get back to the Jeep. Oh, so long, York. Don't be sad. I'll be back.
The flame is getting low on the lighter. Well, I won't need it much longer. What? What was that? The wind isn't so loud. Where's the ladder to the hatchway? So dark. Oh. Wait a minute, what is this? The shovel. Oh, the wind blew the hatch down. Well, that's all right. I'll just climb up and force it open. Now, here's a ladder. There's a ladder. Now, here's the hatch. Now, let's get it open and get back to the Jeep. Seems to be stuck. I think it's giving a little. I have to rest a minute. Catch my breath. The wind is really getting strong out there. Wind. Sand. Oh, my God, it'll blow the sand on the deck. It'll cover the hatch. Pile it up. Tons and tons of sand. I've got to get the hatch open now. Push harder, Harry. Push harder.
Listening to The Lost Ship, written especially for Suspense by Irwin Lewis. Suspense is produced and directed by Fred Hendrickson. Heard in tonight's story were Matt Cooper, Gene Gillespie, and Bill Adams. Music supervision by Ethel Huber. Sound patterns by Walter Otto. Technical direction by Fred Turner. This is Stuart Metz speaking. Listen again next week when we return with another tale well calculated to keep you in suspense.
Gold fever. Truly the killer of men and their dreams. That was episode number 940 of Suspense. There would only be four more before the series would breathe its last and be canceled. But it wasn't the end of old-time radio. Both Gunsmoke and Johnny Dollar would continue on that year until September 30th, 1962, which is considered the end of the golden age of radio. The good news is that old-time radio never really died. Today, it continues on the Internet Archive. You can listen to these great old shows anytime you have a mind to. There are about 900 episodes of Suspense just waiting for you there. It's amazing. That was episode number 632, and I want to thank Willie Mays for his amazing catch, and of course Faye Rogers for her very creepy story. Both can only be described as amazing. If you want to follow the podcast or the blog, head to ronsamazingstories.com. There you will find any of the links I mentioned and how to contact us. Do you want to help the show? The best thing you can do is to tell your friends all about it, and please leave reviews or feedback wherever you listen. Clicking that follow or like button helps us grow. Thank you for listening, and I hope you come again to find out what are Ron's amazing stories.
All of the vintage audio used in the podcast is believed to be in the public domain. Ron's Amazing Stories does not own the rights to any of the old-time radio used here. If you hold the rights to any of the shows played, please contact us immediately at ronsamazingstories.com.